Good afternoon, everyone. Another article, this time by NASA, saying global cooling, here now. Stephen Goddard, censored, sensitive material. Oh, it's just a timeline of ice core temperature graphs showing the Earth was warmer 1,000 and 5,000 years ago. More crop-destroying weather fronts passing through Asia. Beer prices doubling, using granite dust to increase crop yields. Massive waves in Tenerife slamming apartment buildings. Three halos in the atmosphere intersecting in Zimbabwe. Ice storm aftermath in Northeast U.S. Maritimes, Canada. 25 degrees below normal temperatures. And if you're wanting to understand more what a grand solar minimum is and how it's going to affect your and my life, I've put together a reading list here on Amazon for you. Also, the electric universe, how our star has an electromagnetic connection to Earth and what that also means with jet streams and our weather and ultimately your food prices. And if you're on the go through the day, take a listen to Mini Ice Age podcast where I talk about the same issues for 30 minutes at a time on the go. Libsyn, SoundCloud, iTunes, and anywhere else you can find a podcast across the internet. NASA now warns of a long cold winter, icy conditions, global cooling. I wonder what they know about the grand solar minimum. Here's another article, Mini Ice Age on the way. You're starting to see it across the headlines. I'm wondering why right now they're starting to put this out through the mainstream media. But when you look at solar cycle 25 and 26, perhaps they're trying to warn the world, or I would think they're just trying to protect themselves, saying, hey, we told you about this. Don't look at us. And speaking of that, rye down 30% this year in global production, barley as well. Prices of beer are going to double. Also taking a look at hops, which has also been affected by the cooler, wetter conditions than normal. Sum it up, decreased beer supply, increased beer prices. Now this is such a simple chart to sum up the rest of your life moving forward from this point. It doesn't matter if it's beer, it doesn't matter if it's wheat or barley or rye or sorghum or whatever it is that you eat. From this point forward, there's going to be less of it. So everything you buy is going to be increasing in price. And the question you might pose to yourself is, if you're going to take all this extra money and put it into your food supply, where are you going to be pulling from in the economy that you're not spending? Restaurants, travel, movies, electronics, and how are those industries going to be affected as we move forward? Also, the article here did some really good calculations talking about global consumption of beer is going to decline by 16%. Also, those in less developed economies, they're predicting almost something double on the average global decline in consumption. They're using Argentina as a test case. So we're already starting to see this push and pull. If prices become too expensive, that cuts right into the consumption. But at what point do these two things disconnect where you have to have it to stay alive and it doesn't matter what it costs? You're still going to buy it, steal it, fight for it, or die for it. Now with the changing magnetosphere, we're expecting these atmospheric changes along with the jet stream, cloud bands and cloud patterns, cloud cells across the planet moving into different locations. Here is a perfect example of what is on tap and how our crops are going to be wiped out from this point forward. You see the compressed line between extreme heat and extreme cold on the two edges of the front here. That really thin line is the most extreme weather you could possibly imagine. There's going to be 1 pound hailstones in the middle of that, hurricane force winds, and anything that's out in the fields is just going to be absolutely destroyed by either wind, rain, or hail. Now I know we're coming into the end of harvest time, but as that front descends, it's going to go right through Heilongjiang and Mongolia. These are major wheat producers on a planet, and we see the Chinese dynasties collapsing and again and again, every grand solar minimum, and we see these kind of fronts now passing through. If this becomes the norm on every single weather front, Chinese crop production is finished in the northern part of their country. Hence all the trade wars, hence all the tariffs, and hence the possible conflicts to remove the troublemakers off the streets. Ever heard of a draft? And as we do get deeper into these crop losses, we're going to have every single possible solution at our fingertips. Well, here's one. This is from 1894, where they were talking about using granite dust to increase crop yields without having to use fertilizers. I put a little bit yellow at the bottom, point number four. This granite dust, they call it stone meal, helps plants resist drought and frost. Oh my, we should start using this right now with traditional agriculture. Additionally, it creates immunity to fungi. Now we're going into the mold and fungus period right now due to too much excessive moisture. I wonder if this is a double solution here. And when I say bred from granite, I really mean this thing right here turned into dust, into the fertilizer to increase your crop yield so you can get a loaf of bread out of this. And we're just one small planet and one small solar system revolving around our galaxy here. Our neighboring star systems affect us. The flow through plasma and the Birkeln currents affects our star. It's on a cyclical pattern. It's mappable, and we're in it again. And when you start talking about long-term temperature trends, it seems to be considered sensitive material. Stephen Goddard just talking about ice core graphs showing the exact opposite of what you think. It was much warmer in the medieval warming period 1,000 years ago, and you go back 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 graphs, then much warmer, 10,000, like a heat wave compared to today. Why is this deemed sensitive? And I thought, let me open that and let me see how sensitive this is for me. Here they go. It's a temperature graph. Yet Twitter thought this was sensitive material enough to block it. This is the kind of censorship that's going on right now, so you don't see what's happening with the long-term temperature trends and also these cycles repeating. Speaking of which, let's take a look over the last 12,000 years. Sunspot activity equals heat activity on our planet. You can see where the drop-offs are. And if you map that back through time in the last 3,000 years, you can get a good connection between civilization declines and solar activity declines. The Maunder minimum, which is at the far right of your chart when you go to the very bottom where you hit that bottom blue line, that's where we're going again. You would expect atmospheric changes, wind velocity, out-of-season storms. Here's another one. Tenerife. Buildings usually have beach for 150 feet in front of that apartment complex. The waves are so large that when they're crashing, now look on the right side, they're popping up 30, 40 feet and ripping balconies off the building. I linked everything below. That is a video you must watch. And we've also seen this ramp up in sightings of sun halos and the intensity of them. But this is something I've never seen before. Three sun halos overlapping in Zimbabwe. The geometry in the sky on this is mythical in itself. Now, meanwhile, the blizzard in New York and the all-time record snows across Northeast United States and so many places across U.S. and Canada, Mexico, North America, Russia, ice storms at the exact same days. Take a look at how thick the ice is here. I would not want to have to be trying to scrape the car off or get that moving. And I did want to drop in one of the most amazing photos that I've seen out of the fires in California. You know, I've looked through a lot of these images, heard a lot of stories about causations of what enhanced this fire damage and also the way it spread. It's not about that. It's about what nature has done here, and this is visible from space, and I really want you to stop here and take a look at how this fire is putting out so much smoke and ash that it's equivalent to a volcanic eruption. Now, for those of you that have just experienced the super freeze and record snows across the Northeast U.S. and other parts, Southeast U.S., it's not anywhere close to being finished yet. Now this record cold from Alberta is going to sweep down through the Central Plains states. You can see that dark purple at the top there. It's 20 degrees Fahrenheit below the normal temperatures. And as we move through eastern Canada, Maritimes, they're already cold. And the eastern part of the United States, Northeast, New York, Vermont, New Hampshire, etc., already cold. Record cold. But what is on tap for November 22nd is shocking. These temperatures that you're witnessing here, every single city that is included in this map is going to break a temperature record, all-time temperature record. That is going to be tens of thousands of temperature records broken just on this small little map here. So I'm going to bring you over here to what's expected as we move through this point from November 22nd all the way up and through Thanksgiving 24th. Providence, Rhode Island is the old record at 30 degrees Fahrenheit down to 24. Boston expected to smash its record as well. That 22 is now dropped to 19, but that was broken back in 1901. And we see the same thing in New York. Forecast highs are even set to be lower than what the record temperatures are now with this new update in the forecast models. Something unusual is going on. They're trying to deflect and say, don't look at this event. They can't even explain it through global warming that it's creating the cooling because it's so anomalous and so intense. And when they're looking at the forecast lows, places like Burlington, which you just saw on the previous chart, they're looking at 8 degrees Fahrenheit coming up on Thanksgiving morning. Pittsburgh, 16 degrees Fahrenheit on Thanksgiving. These are absolutely incredible temperatures. It would generally only reach this type of low late January, early February, the very coldest of the winter. Yet this is a full month before winter even starts. So as we enter into the grand solar minimum, you can expect more of these anomalies. And I'm going to bring you a few days past Thanksgiving. What do you see in the center of the U.S.? Oh, extreme cold, but I want you to look down in Mexico. It's going to be 16 to 20 degrees Fahrenheit below normal temperatures there getting into the end of the month. Now, where we also see these extreme heat bordered with the extreme cold, you can only imagine that these weather events with the wind, the hail, the sideways blowing, darting, freezing rain. Luckily, most of the crops have already been harvested because whatever's left after these events will be non-harvestable. Welcome to Your Food Prices Up. Indefinitely, as long as you live, your food prices will increase from this point forward, thanks to the grand solar minimum. Thanks for watching. Hope you got something out of the video. You can take this info on the go and listen through your day. Mini Ice Age Conversations podcast anywhere. Podcasts are hosted across the net.